Well, it's a topic that weaves in and out of the news and our conversations and will for some time to come, the legalization of cannabis. So joining us this evening is the CEO of OrganiGram, Inc. That's a publicly traded licensed producer of medical marijuana in Canada. And we're going to chat about some of the questions that surround all this. Welcome, Greg Engel, to What She Said.
Great. Thanks for having me today.
So before we start really getting into it, can you give us a update on where we stand now and what the milestones are that we should be watching for in terms of the law, where we stand legally?
Sure. No, it's a great question. So we've had a federally regulated medical program in place for over 3 years now. Mm-hmm. It's called the ACMPR, or Access to Cannabis for Medical Purposes Regulations. And under those regulations, patients get a medical document, which is basically a prescription from their physician, and submit that to a licensed producer like OrganiGram, and then can have their product shipped directly to their home. In the future, certainly we've seen from the federal government that they're moving towards legislation and bringing in a controlled and regulated adult recreational program by July of 2018, which is the target they're working towards right now.
Yes, it's amazing how many people think it's this July. It's like not going to happen.
Right. So, and again, we continue to kind of hear that. But certainly we know it's going to take some time to develop the framework of the regulations. And we know that the provinces are going to be responsible for distribution as well. So a lot of work to be done on that side.
Let's now dig down. What is the difference between medical cannabis and recreational cannabis?
Yeah, it's a great question. So medical cannabis, if you really think about how, you know, the most common primary uses for medical cannabis are chronic pain and mental health, and certainly lots of areas under both of those. And with that, you see a pretty broad range of products. So there's two active ingredients in cannabis, THC, which is the widely known psychoactive compound, and CBD or cannabidiol, which is a non-psychoactive compound. So you tend to see a mix of products with those two active ingredients, both in a vaporizable smoke form or in an oral ingestible form. Because CBD also has a lot of use in other indications beyond, you know, it's for use for chronic pain and seizures and other areas, but having that non-psychoactive element is one of the key factors.
So that means you don't get stoned.
Exactly. Basically, okay. It doesn't have the intoxicating effect that you would expect.
All right, you said it nice, much more nicely than I did.
So as a producer, we've heard about certain things like corn strains that are able to withstand pests. Have producers now then refined the strains to get the product that they want or need for medicinal?
Yeah, and that's absolutely. I think two of the biggest challenges for licensed producers like OrganiGram have been, one, having a broad range of strains available. Because if you think of how cannabis is used, you know, there's two primary strains called indica and sativa. Indicas are more sedating, and sativas are more activating, kind of on a daily basis. And then there's the CBD forms, which have this non-psychoactive element. So there's a lot of work that's gone on to breed towards certain products that are you know, offering those products within them. And then in addition to that, we're also producing products for oral ingestion, and we're able to produce a different mix of compounds within those products. So allowing patients today in the medical program to access products that they don't have to smoke or vaporize.
I've also seen topical creams. Ointments.
Yeah, so certainly there's a limited number of topical creams available in Canada. And you see, and that's one of the things that I think we'll see as we move towards an adult, you know, regulated adult recreational program next year, is a broader range of products being available
How will that move affect the licensed producers?
Well, it's a great question. So on one hand, we see continued support for the medical program because we continue to see insurance coverage, you know, growing over time. And we have federal programs for veterans, for example, that cover medical cannabis. So there will always be a place for medical cannabis. And we think it's important for product development. But as we move towards an adult recreational program, I think one of the keys that the federal government has already been made aware of and they've indicated is that it'll be important to have these other forms available, because if you look at the you know, black market today, a lot of those forms are being sold or used in the black market. And for licensed producers like OrganiGram to compete, we need to be able to have a wide range of offerings because people are looking for different options.
What should Canadians know about cannabis and its legalization?
That's a pretty broad, sweeping question.
I know.
But I think, you know, I think there's kind of three key things. One is that, you know, the government's very focused. The legislation that we've seen drafted already and that we're moving towards is really focused on the health and safety of Canadians. So having a regulated and controlled system which ensures access to adults. So again, this is an adult recreational program, and that's one of the focuses. The second thing is that, you know, certainly we have seen and heard some stories about oral ingestion use products in the United States and some challenges with that. But we certainly are optimistic and look forward to working with the federal government to bring in forms that have dosage limits, for example, because some of those issues we've heard about other states have been people ingesting levels much higher than they had anticipated and have had an effect that they weren't ready for. And that's one of the things as you move towards oral products, unlike a smoked or vaporizable form, it can take 16 to 90 minutes to have an effect. So people should be cautioned when those products are available not to take more because you haven't had an effect. And I think that's one of the key things. And the third is that, you know, as we move towards our program, one of the key things that people will be looking for is a variety of products, as you asked earlier. So I think it'll be important that a number of licensed producers, both large and small, are in the marketplace so that they can offer a pretty broad range of products.
What about public safety?
Yeah, public safety, again, continues to be a big issue. We're a big supporter, and I've certainly in the past had a lot of discussions around, first of all, we are supportive of not co-locating, you know, cannabis with alcohol from a distribution perspective. We think there are a lot of people that use cannabis, and we continue to hear this, as a harm reduction strategy. So if they've had alcohol addiction issues, they turn to cannabis as an alternative. So it's important not to force them into locations that, you know, sell alcohol. In addition to that, one of the things around public safety, as I said, is making sure that the structure of distribution, so whether or not that's initially a mail order program like we have today or you know, a mix of different independent storefront type locations, that they have a kind of, you know, they have a process in place to make sure that, you know, legitimately they're only serving adults, whatever the age mm-hmm. is, that's going to be critical. And that's one of the things that's key in Colorado, for example.
So, I mean, we see the storefronts everywhere. I mean, I have three within walking distance of my house. So, do you think that they can be sufficiently regulated to remain in place if they haven't been rated and shut down before then?
Yeah, I think that's a question for the government to answer. Mm-hmm. Certainly each province is going to look at that independently. And certainly on one hand, there's a lot of kind of expertise and knowledge that have been associated with, you know, people working in that area. But they don't have a regulated and controlled supply mm-hmm. chain today. So the product that's going in is not necessarily tested or routinely tested. And that's one of the key things that we ensure, because safety is not just about the accessibility, but it's also about the product you provide and making sure that it's, you know, undergoes rigorous testing for distribution.
Yeah, you're talking about distribution. I'm going back to saying you don't think it should be distributed in a place that also serves alcohol.
Correct.
I have heard a lot of concern expressed by people who feel that unless it's a facility that already is used to screening for age,
sure,
et cetera, that they're concerned about this storefront, the little private storefront, not being able to enforce that.
No, and it's
not
a great
being trained.
Yeah, it's a great question. So certainly, and I was on a panel recently at a conference with the head of the OPSU and the LCBO, and you know, one of the discussions that he was outlining and that kind of you have to think about is certainly, for example, that group has a history and a system in place to do mm-hmm. that checking of age. But is the location appropriate, or are they better off to set up their own independent locations, you know, that provide cannabis only? And I think across Canada, we have a variable framework on how alcohol is distributed today. So, you know, in each province, there are systems in place, whether or not it's privately owned or provincially run, mechanisms to ensure that underage, you know, minors are not being sold alcohol. And I think that's important for cannabis as well.
Are other countries looking to us as a blueprint for what they do?
Yeah, so certainly, you know, Canada is really, you know, the first of the kind of G20 or G7 countries to look at a federally legal regulated program. You know, the first country, Uruguay, is the first country to move towards a kind of adult recreational program. But certainly we've been a model for the medical program to date, and countries like Germany have been in a lot of contact with licensed producers like ourselves, as well as the government, to look at framework. And the expectation is in the adult recreational program will be the same. So Canada will be looked at, and certainly everything we put in place is a model.
Greg Engel, thank you so much for joining us today and educating us and all our listeners.
Great. Well, thanks again for having me.
This is What She Said. Stay with us.